It's clear our readings are talking to us about humility.
Tony, wait one second. Wait one second.
And looking up some things about humility, one saint was asked, after faith, hope, and charity, which are the greatest virtues? And the saint replied, humility, humility, humility. That's hard for us. Very hard to be humble. Because sometimes I think we get it confused with some other things. It doesn't mean necessarily we're doormats and people just walk over us. To be humble is to take seriously the great commandment of Jesus when he says to love your neighbor as yourself. Well, that's exactly what being humble is about. That's putting everyone else before you. Everyone. And we know that Jesus said, that's friend and foe alike. Everyone before you. So the other becomes the object of our actions. To make them feel welcome. To make them feel affirmed. To help them see the positivity in their presence with us. To acknowledge them, to assist them. Very soon, on September 4th, one of the great women of the church will be canonized a saint. I think you may have heard of her. Mother Teresa of Calcutta. First of all, I should have asked if this was anybody not here of her? She's going to be with the big ST in front of her name. And that is probably, to her, humiliating. But when we look at her life, we see she's a great example of humility. Always putting the other first. Whether it was her students, when she was teaching, and then as she became a nurse, her patients, began to identify that Christ was present in all of these. And in her position as a religious consecrated woman was to show them not just by words, but by actions, the love and the grace of Almighty God. And she did that so splendidly, so wonderfully. We know she was acclaimed worldwide. We know that she received the Nobel Peace Prize. And we know these things about her because she stunned the world. People couldn't believe how this little frail nun could have done so much. And she did a lot, even physically. When she walked the streets of Calcutta, India, wherever she was, and she walked the streets and saw people dying in the gutter, she would pick them up, men, women alike, and carry them to her clinic. And if anybody would say to her, Mother Teresa, can I help you with that? She would say, oh no, like Mary, I'm holding Jesus. And she brought them to the clinic, and she herself, with the other sisters, would gently bathe the person, anoint them with nice, fragrant lotions, and put the cleanest linens on them. And they smell and look like a little baby does after you change its diaper. You know, that's when they smell really good. And people would be content, and the sisters would gather around. They would read scripture, they would sing, and they would touch him with their hands so they could be touched and not just standoffish. And she said, what we have done is prepare them to meet Jesus, and they will leave this world knowing that they were loved. And all of the things that follow, the growth of her religious congregation, the clinic, and all of that, are signs of what one little person can do who just took time to show humility. And as I said, humility holds the other first before the Lord God. and before our own actions. And you've heard me say this before. The trinity of the devil often consumes us to make humility difficult to practice, because we think in our culture, especially in America, sorry to say, me, myself, and I first. But that's not what Jesus says. And that's not what we see in the life of the truly dedicated and humble who give of themselves. I think of many more people who are humble. People that go to the military. Even our traffic policeman that's with us, who pleasantly joked with me, "Will we get out before 7:30 when the storm is coming?" I said, "I think so." But what I'm trying to say is, all these people who do things for us and take for granted, to be told we appreciate them. Very importantly, if you take a look at the very first reading today from Sarah, we hear the words about being taught humility and seek humility in all things. And what we hear in that reading is a little lost, but as some of the passage verses are eliminated. But it's like with the first high mountain of God's appearance, Mount Sinai, where he gave the tablets, you know, and there was fire and windstorms. You know what I'm talking about, the movie and the lightning writing on the tablets and stuff. And, "Whoa, this is God, Moses, take your shoes off," you know. And then you look at another mountain and compare. And the second mountain is Mount Zion. And what's at the top of Mount Zion? Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built on a hill. And we see the Old Testament author, Ben Sarah, which was the name for Sarah, says, look at this mountain. It's like angels are there. The Lord's glory is there on Mount Zion. Now, on Mount Zion is where Abraham took Isaac to kill him as an offering that God has requested. But God stopped him by an angel and saw Abraham's faith. So it reminds us that we have to have faith in the Lord, in the covenant, the commandments, and in Jesus Christ, who on the Mount Zion, Jerusalem, was also sacrificed for us. He died in humility. He came in humility from heaven. He's God. To be like us. St. Paul says, he took the form of a slave to be one like us. And Jesus was with us. And we hear in his ministry all of the things. And he must have studied and knew this reading from Sirach, the words of Ben Sarah, about seeking above all things humility. Look at the life of Jesus. Isn't it a story of humility, all that he did? And notice what Jesus did. He spent a lot of time with the poor, the crippled, the leper, the ones who were rejected. Even the lepers, when they were cured, only one came back to give thanks. Somehow the other nine that were cured kind of rebuked him. But we see Jesus not stopping. He kept continuing to show dignity and warmth and love to people. And he loved to be with sinners so that they could be refreshed and that someone cared enough to talk to them, to hang out with them, and to tell them about God's call to them to enjoy his goodness and his love and mercy. And he died a humble death as a criminal on the cross for us all to see, with hands outstretched in humility. And we remember the night before he died, he gave us the Holy Eucharist so we could remember him. And then went to the garden and said, "Oh Father, if you can take this cup away from me, let it be done. But if not, I will do your will." And God the Father did not take that cup away. And Jesus followed through humbly. When we look at the Passion, we see that humility over and over again. How they beat him, scourged him, crowned him, nailed him to a cross, all the things that he endured to be that humble, suffering servant. We are called to be humble. And it's hard to sacrifice because we think too much of ourselves. When you talk to someone, you get to know them like if you've ever been on a plane and traveling alone, or in the passenger next to you. Sometimes as you gauge in conversation, sometimes it's like listening to the ego trophy. It's like a biography, but it's all about, oh, my children all went to college, they went to Harvard and Yale, and they worked here, they do this, or we live here and we have this, and on, it's all about. People like to show their credentials, their importance, their wealth. And it shall not be like that with us. We see what Jesus says in the gospel. When you're invited to a banquet or dinner, don't look for the seat on high. Many times as a priest, as you can imagine, over these 40 years I've been invited to several celebrations and banquets and receptions. And so, hurrying in, sometimes running late, you know, I would look up to see if there was an empty spot at the head table. And I presumed it was mine. So I would hurry up there, and many times it was my seat. So I took my place. And you know what? Sitting at the head table's no delight. Because by the time you're seated, the people to your right or your left are already talking in the conversation with the people on their right or their left. And so there you are, looking at flowers. And a big drop to the nearest person. And then you're there and you feel like everyone's watching you. And so that's when you... Not my normal. It's humiliating sometimes to have that. And how I enjoy sometimes when I go to affairs or invited and there isn't a head table. And you go and pick up your name card and it says table check. And you're with regular folk. The priests and attendants are all scattered through the banquet hall at various tables. I love it! Because we are the people of God, we're one, and are not to be held up on high. I know I'm up here now, but I hope I'm here because I'm a servant for you in humility. To try to give you something to think about in the reading, something to challenge you, something to direct you. And so, as Jesus continues in that parable, then he looks at the person throwing the event and said, when you have events like this, why don't you invite the crippled, the poor, the lame, the blind, all these people who were considered social outcasts to your party? Wow. So you see, we're not to seek position or exaltation in who we are, but to be of service. People like Jesus, Mother Teresa, and myriads of others that work at humility. The root word for humility is the same as that of dirt. Humus. Didn't you study about humus soil? The rich soil of the earth made from decayed things and on it goes. And I'm not talking about pumice that you eat, the pita bread. But I'm talking about humus. It's dirt. And Adam is made of dirt. And we're all dirt. Now, I don't go around look at Vito and say, you're dirt, Vito. She'd get it. Vito would come out. But we're all dirt. We're humus. We're all equal. So no matter what rank or power or title or wealth or whatever, equal in the sight of God. And all of us are invited to his table where there's no distinction. And one of my special hymns we sang for our song response, the Lord hears the cry of the poor. He hears them, and he does everything he can to help them. And there are some that don't want to be helped. He tries to teach and love all of us, to show forgiveness and mercy. So let us all cry out with the Lord and remember it is upon this supreme being that we rely. It is this being above all who created us, who redeemed us, who calls us to a life hereafter. Being humble is knowing who God is and who we are and who one another is in relationship to that plan. So brothers and sisters, let us be humbled and work at that virtue. It's a difficult one many times because our ego gets in the way, prestige or the sense of over flattering ourselves. But in the depths of it all, we're loved by God equally. And he calls us equally to share in his love everlastingly. And the Lord hears our prayers, our cries, the cries of the poor.